Hey, welcome back. So after 2 days of test driving the chassis, cruising it around, it was a blast, but two problems have come up. One, I've got an oil leak, and two, I have a link pin adjustment problem, which creates a big clunk up front. So let's fix the clunk up front. All right, so here is the source of that clunk, and it is the link pin that runs the length here that attaches the lower torsion arm to the upper torsion arm. There's way too much play in this, and I could see the actual play just by wiggling the tire here. It might be difficult to see, but I can certainly feel it when I tug on that tire. So I went through the adjustments when I first put the suspension together, but something's gone wrong. So what happens is you have to measure and understand the gap between the top and the bottom, because the bottom torsion arm is actually extending out millimeters more than the top. In order to compensate for that, there's shims at the top, inner and outer, and the same at the bottom here. There's shims in there that compensate for that millimeter difference, and that prevents this clunk, because this thing has to be, you know, true. It has to be upright, or as you're turning that wheel and you're putting pressure left and right, it's going to pull out and then back, and you're going to get that clunk. So I'm interested to understand what I did wrong here. So I'm going to take this apart. I'm going to remeasure the millimeter, and I will show you how you know the number of shims that you need to place on the inner and outer on both the top and the bottom in order to compensate for that. Okay, so now we need to measure the offset between the upper and the lower. So just get a builder square. You get these at Harbor Freight, our good friends at Harbor Freight. And then a distance gap measure, a little electronic one. I think I paid $9 for this. It's really called a digital caliper. So just rest that builder square against the bottom, tight. So you should be able to see, hopefully you can see the gap that I'm speaking of that wasn't correct and that was the cause of the clunk. And then I'm just going to use the gap measurer here to measure what that gap is. And coming up with 8.8 on that. So now we need to take this to the chart, which explains how we need to compensate for the 8.8 millimeters with the shims that are on the kingpin to the bottom and the top, inner and outer. And I'll show you how to map that out. Hey, I have been checking this out to figure out, trying to figure out what I did wrong. So here is the kingpin, and this is where the brake drum would bolt into, and then of course how you steer it here, just as I took it off. Here's the lateral pin. So as I take this lateral pin out, you will see that the kingpin has a number of different shims here on the outer and then the inner, and that is distributed based on a chart in the manuals to compensate for that gap that we just looked at. So when I took this apart, there were 8 shims on the top, 8 shims on the bottom, for a total of 16. So when I looked at the manual, which I was working off of, the chart, which I'll show you here in a second, this is the manual that I was using. And note, it says for 1966, 67, 68, and 69. Well, I'm restoring a 19, 57. So when I looked at a manual that says up to 1959, that chart clearly indicated that there should be 10 shims on each. And so that's why this was clunking, without a doubt. So what's interesting was when I took it apart, there were only 8, which obviously means at some point in time the car was serviced, the mechanic was probably using the wrong manual, just like I was, saw that there was 10 shims in here and said, well, there should be 8, toss the other 2. So this thing for decades has been incorrect. So what I'm trying to say is I'm not responsible. It's not my fault. It's the other mechanic's fault. I didn't do it. I'm just kidding. I'll take 50% of the responsibility. So at any rate, I've ordered a couple more shims. So I have 10 on each. And so let's now take a look at how we take that difference, which was that 8.8 that I measured earlier on the caliber. And when we look at that chart, it will show you clearly how you need to map out these shims. So let's take a look at that. All right, back on the bench. So I've laid out my shims in a little diagram here. Call out to wide 5, if you're not familiar with wide 5. Wide 5. They've got a pretty decent YouTube site specializing in these spindles. So I've got the spindle here to the driver's side. This would be your outer here. This would be the inner portion once we're back loading it. And so I've laid this out, driver side, passenger side. I'm working on the driver side, outer, inner for the top part, outer and inner for the lower torsion arm. So I have discovered the correct diagram, which I should be using. And if you remember, the distance between the lower torsion arm and the upper was 8.8, so I'm going to round that up to a difference of 9 millimeters. So for the upper torsion arm, the inner shim needs to be 7, the outer needs to be 3. So here we are. So the outer needs to be 3, inner needs to be the 7. So I've got my 7 staged here. Whoops, I've got my 3 staged here. So going back to our diagram for the lower torsion arm. Here's the lower, right? It needs to be 3 inner, 7 outer. So here's my 3 inner and my 7 outer. And then we're going to load these up to the lower torsion arm and then drive our pins in there, and then it should be ready to go. So you want to grease these up really well. So more grease, the better. So just get all of these lubed up real well. So here's the upper inner. Get it into the outer. And we're gonna do the same thing with the inner lower, which is just a 3. Making a good mess here. Just getting these all greased up. And then we've got our pins. All right. Looks bloody. Now we're ready to load this thing up. When you go to load these back up, you're probably gonna need some help because this lower torsion arm is gonna fall a little bit. So I brought in a jack stand and just put some pressure to bring this up to the distance so these two pins can just kind of slide in there. And you might need a hammer to pound those in. And then at that point, it's just putting your bolts back on here and getting those real tight and getting everything just married back up. So let's do that and let's see if this works. I'm hopeful and I think it will.
So I got everything back together, put the tire back on, set it back down on the ground, and yeah, when I started to jingle this around, there's no more of that clunking noise, so that was it. So remember, if you're restoring a Volkswagen before 1960 is when they made that change to HMs, they introduced a rubber O-ring. So for those earlier ones, it's a little bit different. So I hope this video's helped. That diagram can be found in old shop manuals. Check out thesamba.com. The Samba has some technical stuff. You can find that in there as well for pre and post 1960 as well. So I hope it's helped. Thanks for watching. See you.